Hi, this is Francis Rossi.
I'm Rick Parfitt
from Stateless Crow.
And you're watching our Top of the Pops 2 special.
That's right, boys, and good evening. I'm Steve Wright. This is Top of the Pops 2 from HQ here in Elstree. Tonight, we celebrate the raw power of a band revered through almost four decades of pop history. Pops 2 on BBC 2 salutes Status Quo.
Caroline was a song Bob and I wrote when we were on holiday in Perranporth in England. And we'd written it as a slow shuffle. You want to, don't you? And we were doing it in rehearsals, it wasn't really sitting. Then we tried to double time and Rick went, didn't you?
And there it was.
And there it was. And, and it develops. The enjoyable times when it starts as one thing and grows into something.
It's got to be called Margaret.
Yeah, Margaret didn't work. Come on,
sweet Margaret.
It's not got it.
Not the same, is it?
Rockin', especially for Top of the Pops 2. Rick and Francis and the boys big up their own hits for us. Here's Jimmy Savile and Dave Cash.
Ladies and gentlemen, up from number 15 of last week to number 10 of this week, pictures of Max Tickman, The Status Quo.
The boys haven't changed a bit.
When I look up to the sky, I see your eyes, a funny kind of yellow. I rush home to bed, I suck my head, I see your face underneath my pillow. I wake next morning, time's still yawning, see your face come peeking through the window.
Of Matchstick Men was the Clo's first major success. Rick picks up the story.
We had Matchstick Men, and I mean, it changed our lives. I remember Pat saying in the Lambeth Walk, which is where the showroom was, I think Matchstick Men was about number 11 in the charts or something, and he said, right, he said, give up your jobs, you're going professional. And I remember it was like one of those pictures you see from the 60s where you'll leap up in the air, you know, and the action stops.
And that led us to
a fantastic moment.
It was our first major television, which was Top of the Pops. It's lucky those first Top of the Pops were in black and white, because I mean, if it were in colour, it was horrendous. It was dreadful. I mean, it was gold, red and gold and yellow, and and we didn't kind of like that, you know. And we thought to ourselves, well, we were getting a bit disillusioned with it, like Francis just said, with the audiences and dressing up like this with these frilly shirts and stuff. And we rather took a chance, I think, really, and kind of turned our backs on it. Came off the road for about a year in 1969. Or so, and we just rehearsed up a new set and decided that we wanted to wear jeans and pumps and to go completely the other way. I mean, the jeans had to be ripped, you know, the kneecaps had to be out of them. And if we'd buy some Glorias, these Gloria Gaynor's trainers,
and pumps then as well,
they were pumps, yeah. There's no rhyming slang to that, is there?
No, never mind,
you got it. But they had to be filthy. I mean, we'd kick them around in the dirt until they were dirty. And just an old T-shirt, and that's... We grew the hair, and that's really how we wanted to be, you know, unshaven. Really went the other way.
Mistakes, forgive me. Would you like to ride my butterfly? Riding on a long blue paper plane, getting seasick, sorry, once again. A landing strip is getting nearer, all the fog lifts makes it clearer. Then I mistakes, forgive me. Would you like to ride my paper plane? We'll be right back.
years, they've shouted, "Oi, got any quo?" It's the Quo Special on BBC Two's Top of the Pops 2.
Well, it was nice to have the one, the number one down. It's, some people say it's a shame you've only had the one number one. Well, to me, we had, I think Down was number one with something like 380,000 pieces. What you're proposing was number two with something like 600,000 or 700,000. We were held off number one by something like Barbara Streisand or something like that. So it depends, you know, it's great to have a number one, but ideally the more people you get through to me is the better. So you look at how many pieces you've sold, that's the better song. Sounds business vibe, but I meant to get through.
Down, 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 Status Quo special Top of the Pops 2. Now, what about those clothes, those jeans? Here's Quo in 1980. What you're proposing?
I mean, we're wearing, you know, all denim. I mean, you go to a Quo gig after that, everybody started to wear the jeans and the jackets and stuff like that. So Levi came on, apparently. I mean, him and I don't know too much about the deal, but I do know how we were paid for it. Right? Levi, big, right? Worldwide, Levi, Quo, sponsoring Levi. We got a roll of denim. Hey, old lads, you can have some clothes made.
Here sitteth two schmucks.
That was 1980. Now, year 2000. Here's the Quo blowing the roof off the place. This is Roll Over, Lay Down. Top of the Pops 2. Here's an insight into Francis's private life.
A lot of people think that the lyrics to Roll Over, Lay Down are literally about sex. And at the time, again, my ex-wife, dear girl.
That's right.
And she used to, if she wanted a row, if there was a problem, she would stay up and sit on my side of the bed, sit up in it and fall asleep. And I'd got home one night before that, and I was telling my son the other night, I came home, she was doing these cheese, potato and onion pies, and the kitchen was alive and the house was all going. It was great to come home, you know. I got a cup of tea even and this pie, and then the following night, it couldn't have been any more different. And I said, sort of, roll over, lay down and let me in. And that's the whole thing about the song. When I got home that night, early one morning, seeing the note written in ink pinned at the door, it's just how it is in this group, I'm sorry.
Thank you. tell us how not changing either their clothes or their style has somehow kept them fresh. What you gonna do with those faded blues you wear?
What you gonna do with those old rag blues? Very strange people about in the 80s. Weird kind of fashions came and went. But I mean, you know, we stayed true to ourselves and to our fans, and just went on how we were, the long hair and the denims, and we still hadn't showered or bathed. And I mean, it was around that time that they were thinking of giving us our own spaces in the car park at the old studios in Wood Lane, because I think, you know, we're building up to sort of 60, 70 Top of the Pops appearances, you know, which was going to go on to, I think this is our 102nd or 103rd performance. In those days, Top of the Pops used to go out live every couple of weeks or something. They'd do a live show. So this particular night, it was going out live, and I'd seen the faces all sort of run off stage and thought, fantastic, isn't that great? And nobody could do anything about it because it's gone out, you know? So I said to the drummer, look, I'm going to walk into the kit tonight. I'd had a few drinks anyway, because we did in those days, you know, before a TV. Get drunk, get pissed. So I said, I'm going to walk in towards the end. I'm going to just walk into the kit. And I said, just go with me, you know. They said, all right. And I didn't tell the others. Right? They didn't know I was going to do it. And so that's what happened. I just walked into the kit. But it was actually quite deliberate. And, you know, nobody believed me. They all said, you just didn't know what was happening, did you? I said, I did know what was happening. It's so difficult to convince people that it was deliberate. We'll be right back.
Here comes the one you've been waiting for and the story behind it. Whatever you want. What about that one then, Rick?
Whatever you want. I wrote it with Andy Bowne, our keyboard player. We wrote it at my house down in Surrey. Took us about 2 or 3 hours to write it. We got extremely drunk whilst writing it, and the lyric is just a fantastic lyric. Da 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 da, whatever you want. It's advertised just about everything.
Whatever you want. Now, in 1986, the Quo surprised us. He is in the army now.
I think the one record that we made as a record, rather than recording a status quo, and really quite proud of it, you know. If we're not proud of our other ones, but that one we really are. We can detach ourselves, and
it's class, isn't it?
It's a classy record, whether, you know.
You'll be the hero of the neighborhood. Nobody knows that you left for good. You're in the army now.
more exclusive stuff from The Quo here at L Street. This is Rain. Never forget, these boys can play guitar, they can sing, and they can rock. Pay tribute to Top of the Pops, a show that's almost as old as they are.
Top of the Pops, I think, to us, it's establishment, and I don't mean that in a derogatory sense. It's, like I said, there's so many shows around the world that base themselves on this show and started with this show that are long, long gone, and this one still exists. It still has that. You know, nobody. There were times and various artists would say, well, they wouldn't do a particular show because it's not good, it's not right for their image, this stuff, you know, all this stuff. Sorry, Pop. Top of the Pops, people just go, yep, I'll do Top of the Pops. Don't matter who they are, yep, I'll do Top of the Pops. It never has any, no barriers, no class barriers, no hip barriers. You just do Top of the Pops. And I think that's good because it's a vehicle. And if you're going to be in this business, if you're going to make records, don't pretend you don't want people to hear them or you don't want to be a particular show because it's not good. We do, and I know, I think lots of other people do. I don't care who likes it. I don't care what demographic he comes from, what earning bracket he comes from. If you like us, fantastic, and that's why I think we want to do things. You want to be liked. And if we didn't want to be liked, you stay at home and be a serious musician and just study. But we want to be liked by people, and I think this is one of the best vehicles there's ever been.
It's been very instrumental in changing our lives, Top of the Pops. It's been partly due to putting us where we are today.
That's it for this Quo special here on Top of the Pops 2. I'm Steve Wright, and we'll see you next week. So, what about rocking all over the world? We'll be right back.
heard this song come on the radio, John Fogerty, rocking all over the world. I thought, love that, just liked it, you know. And suddenly dawned on me, well, we should do that. You know, I'd never heard it before, and that would be great for Quo. And much like in the army now, I never sort of heard this song again. It wasn't a hit in England. I thought, yes, get hold of that. So got a copy of it, took it to the band, and again, like army, nobody was really interested. Yeah, we might do it. And we'd recorded what was going to be the Rockin' All Over the World album in Sweden, I think it was. And and I said, you know, the album was more or less complete, and I said, look, we're going to have a go at this song. Oh, all right. And so and we sort of did it as a last-minute thing, and the rest is history, as they say, rocking all over the world.